Norwegian violinist Elbjørg Hemsing made her solo debut with the Bergen Philharmonic at the age of 11. After winning various international competitions and prizes, at the age of 18 her desire was to continue intensive studies with Boris Kushnir. Following recordings of concertos by Borgström and Shostakovich, Dvorak and Suk, and by Tan Dun, Elbjørg Hemsing is following in the footsteps of her great-great-grandfather, who once inspired Edvard Grieg to compose one of his most famous works. This happened in Elbjørg Hemsing's birthplace, Aurdal, in the valley of Valdres. We're having our interview in the old trading house, which also Edvard Grieg visited.
So I believe very much, and this is also supported by a lot of scientists, who very, very clearly say, if you don't have music in your life from a really early age, you also don't develop a certain sense of your empathy, a certain sense of your well-being, a certain sense of your creativity. And that's music in a broader sense, not necessarily only classical music. But then you also have, on the other side, also the studies that show that if you learn to play an instrument, the kind of exercise your brain are getting from learning something like this, I think they did an experiment where they were putting on electrolytes to see what lighted up at what point. And as soon as you had something with music, it was like fireworks up there. So you really engage your whole, both your membrane, your inner remembrance, and also the outside part. So I mean, just brain-wise, it's a fantastic, interesting topic, because there's so much more that has to be studied, of course, but what I think is also extremely important is that music should also just be for your soul, also for your well-being in many ways. Music should also sometimes just be music as well, doesn't have to be proven by science either. But what I think very much is that it's also it was a professor in one of the Ivy League schools in the US who once said that yes, in the school, of course, everyone has to learn advanced math, advanced, sciences, as well as history and whatnot. But he was very, very cautious about saying we have to have art and music, because that's what makes us human. And that kind of just a little quote has somehow stuck with me, because I think that's so true. Also, just having the art and the way of expressing yourself. For many people, using art is also a very efficient way of learning. For instance, if you look into the school system, not everyone fits to exactly how the classroom is being set up. And for some children, they're having art in their life, expressing yourself through art, being able to learn through art, makes them, we'll say, flourish a bit more than just purely sciences. And then I don't think I know of that many other art forms where you can go from feeling the utmost happiness to the utmost despair in a matter of minutes. There's something about music that is so much speaking to you in certain ways that you can't almost explain. And that power and that kind of, what do you call it, well-being or comfort or just a curiosity, it can also be, is a vessel that is so important to give access to many people so they can also experience that, I think.
So what's the angle? Do we have to change the school system towards more music? Do we have to change our health system even towards more music?
I think actually both of them. First of all, I see it quite simply also in the schools, even in Norway, where it was not so long ago they tried to take away choir practice and try to take away the 1 hour of music they have per week. And luckily people were so in uproar of it, because music is quite celebrated and quite an important part. So that did not go. But for instance, if you just think about in a little community and you have a choir, just so much that is kind of in certain ways also a little democracy in its own little form. You come together, you sing, you feel happiness, you feel relief. But going back to your question, yes, I believe very much it has to start from the ground down. I mean, of course, some people do get the curiosity for music at a later stage in their life, and nothing wrong with that. But we do also see that a lot of young children who, well, not even not necessarily young, but young adults, people that are not, that hasn't been exposed to music from a young age, they will have a certain sense of feeling of that this is something they are not interested in, this is something that will not give them anything. And most of the case, it's just because they haven't been exposed to it. They have never, for instance, been a concert venue, they've never actually heard a proper concerto, classical concerto, for instance. So I think that's extremely important. And then when it comes to the for the elderly, for instance, which is in healthcare quite often, you can see that people, especially with very serious illnesses like Alzheimer's or memory loss, is a big part of their daily life and daily struggle. Sometimes if you just hear music, somehow that memory, that notion is so much linked in their back memory somewhere, that kind of makes them also, the happiness comes out, of course, but it also then you can also get out other memories around the same time. And I think that's an incredibly powerful tool. So I mean, for the use, for their well-being, of course, it's really vital.
You're now speaking exactly on that topic, music and health. How did that come?
It's a good question. I think I can only speak for myself, but I know how extremely important music is in my life and how much I've turned to it in times that have been very difficult, how much comfort you find in it. And I feel very fortunate to be able to play an instrument, because in many ways I feel like that's my voice. And if something is, whether it actually is, can also be incredible happiness, but also the biggest sorrow, the way to express it is for me through music. And being able to put words in certain ways, that's how it feels like. And it's very hard to describe in certain ways why it is so, but it just happens to be so. And that's why I really hope and wish and try to make more people have this experience with music, because I think it's one of the most magical things there is.
We are here in a special room where Edvard Grieg, the national musician, the national composer of Norway, stayed in your hometown,
yes.
Which is Aurdal. Why is being rooted not only in a home place, but also in music, something that shapes your whole life?
I think in many ways, what I think about this place in particular, but also in Edvard Grieg's music in certain ways also, is this what Norway for me stands for, which is the really purity, things that are just so rooted down into to the earth, you know. We also have, of course, fantastic nature around, which also in certain ways, I think, make you self in balance. The power of nature is also undeniable, and I think it makes you somehow you know where your heart is centered at, and you know where your feet should be, and that's, I think, it's the best kind of background you possibly can have. And in order to also have music around it, I mean, that's I think it's a very good combination.
This area is known for very early research in music, and when you start researching and valuing your roots,
yeah,
then automatically the development will not be stopped, but rather be stabilized.
Yes, I think that's also very true. And I was very surprised myself to learn how much was coming out from this region. A lot of the things I've learned, particularly for folk music, have been passed on from generation to generation. And there's no doubt that something has been lost in between those layers of generations, because per tradition you're not supposed to write anything down, but luckily they did have some people they sent out, because the people at the National Library, they realized, you know, there's such a big treasure of national identity that we have to somehow collect and make sure that we have this in our archives. So they did send out some people in this area. It was Lindemann, who was a very famous collector. he was himself a very good organist and a composer as well. But he traveled around and he met a lot of people, amongst them my ancestor, my great-great, and possibly another great grandfather, who was living a little bit south of, from Aurdal, where we are now, who sang him some beautiful melodies, I think, and the Lindemann wrote them all down. We actually have a copy of the original at home, and you can see at that point, of course, they wanted to save a bit of paper. You know, they didn't want to, they didn't have, you know, unlimited resources. So everything is written very neatly and very tight, and you have to really look closely to see what it is. But he wrote down one melody from my ancestor, and later on, Edvard Grieg found this by chance, and he used it for both main theme, but also inspiration for one of his biggest piano pieces, which is the ballad Opus 24. And just to know that this came from, first of all, my family, but also that it came from this region, I think speaks a lot about the richness and also the treasures you can find if you just look for it.
You will be performing this now here in this room. Just tell me a little bit about this house, why it was important for everybody who travels through here. I mean, this is the road through Europe.
Yeah.
And still, there's so much preservation here at the same time. How is that possible?
Well, this was also the point between the east and the west in Norway. Most people had to go through here. And this house is like a traveler's lodge. At that point, when they were traveling, they needed a few days of rest on certain places because it was just too much. Either they went with horses. Well, actually, I suppose they did go with horses. And they, of course, needed their rest and they needed to take it easy. Even some people, when they traveled, they didn't even stay for a few days. They stayed for maybe for weeks, maybe for months. This house is very famous for being the gathering point, not only for travelers, but also for the local community. So quite often when there were, for instance, when Grieg was here, or even Hamsun, well, he was actually here for many months, the great writer. And it was not unfamiliar that in the evenings they would have a meal in the big room, and then a fiddler from the area would come and sit and play in a corner and to provide some entertainment, basically. So for instance, the room we are in now is called Spellemannstuga, which quite simply means the fiddler's room. So we can just imagine that, you know, this is where they would maybe they taught each other playing something, had some good conversations. It was just a very relaxed, very cultural place in many ways. And I can imagine also Aurdal at that point in the 1800s. It was not very many influences you would get outside of this house. It was very difficult to travel, and also money-wise. If you wanted to go anywhere, you would walk, pretty much. So I can just imagine that this particular venue, this travel lodge, this Skistasjon, must have been an incredible resource in many, many ways. And maybe you can see just outside, there's a statue standing. It's called the Victoria statue, and this is one of the greatest books by Hamsun, and it's rumored. Well, not only rumored, but they think that this is where he started writing it, which is also quite cool, I think.
Coming back to music, Grieg was here, and this is called the Spellemann's Room, where Grieg actually might have spent his nights. Is that inspiring to have a place like this in an area where you make music also to help preserve it and to include it in your music? We're now in your own festival. How is this all linked together, the internationality you're bringing here and the rootedness?
For me, in many ways, this house, it represents and in certain ways also validates why it is so important to play Grieg, for instance, and why it's so important to keep the traditions and at the same time move them forward into the next part of history. To be able to know and say that, but Grieg was here, he was in the valley, he traveled here, and to know that his notations and influence quite directly came from the roots of the people here, that's for me a very, very important source. At the same time, what I like to think about, if you look in our society today, everything goes so quickly, everything has to be, I mean, it's literally a click away and you can find anything, but being able to actually physically be in a place such as this and just taking the smell, a look at the woods, just imagine what it was like at that point. That I think is very fascinating. and an important little task to do in many ways, just to remember how hard it was also for them to travel. It wasn't just, you know, we can go because we want to. It was months of planning, you know, a lot of resources. It took forever, and of course they weren't really able to tell their loved ones that they were stopping or standing or what they were doing. So one other thing that was also very important in this house is that this was the first place in the village they had the telephone. So whoever wanted to call, they had to come here.